If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice at the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. And we've all run to things we know just ain't right. And there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. Feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. You got chains, oh, he's a chain breaker. If you believe it, if you receive it, you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, you receive it. If you can feel it, somebody testify, testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. You got chains, he's a chain breaker. Oh, if you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. You got chains, oh, he's a chain breaker.
Well, hello, everyone. I'm so glad you're here with me. As you can see, we're not at home in my prayer room. No, we're actually back in the sanctuary. But the only thing that's really missing right here, right now, is you, the congregation. I've got to tell you, I missed you guys so much. But in due time, we know we'll be back all together, and we're going to have a blast, you know, just getting into worship and getting into the Word. But meanwhile, you know, we're still going to do these videotaping sessions, but I'm so glad you're here. So why don't we get into the Word right now? Let's start off with a word of prayer. Let's pray. Father God, we just want to thank you, Lord, for this time. As we truly know, our hearts belong to you. I pray that you will speak life into us right now as we are ready to receive from you today. I pray truly your words will come alive in such a way that our minds, our hearts, our souls will be touched. And we know, Lord, as we choose to live according to your word, Father, you are pleased. And truly the blessings will flow as we live according to your words, according to your ways. So, Lord, we thank you for what you're going to do in this time. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise God. Well, if you take a look at the notes, today the title of the sermon is How to Stay at Home 24/7 with Your Family Without Having to Strangle Them. Yeah, you heard right. But, you know, as you all know, right, with the pandemic that we're facing, many family members are forced to stay at home with each other 24/7 around the clock. And it seems like we're always in each other's faces, right? And this usually means, you know, the husband and wife and their children, and in some cases, you know, it could be an extended family. We're talking about like aunts and uncles and cousins and even friends, right? But, you know, I got to tell you, according to one article that I read on the internet, you know, because of this, many relationships have been severely strained. If not 24/7, right? We know it's like a lot of hours that these people are spending time with each other, and many more hours than they are accustomed to. And because of this, did you know there are rising levels of domestic abuse in the households, where there are many heated arguments and yelling among the spouses, the parents and the children, among siblings, and on and on and on. And I gotta tell you, there are cases where the police have to come to the house because the neighbors are hearing all the screaming and the yelling. Can you imagine that? Well, you know, during the past several months with the pandemic outbreak, there has been an increase with couples filing for divorce. Yeah, can you believe that? You know, many divorce lawyers are recommending couples to wait until the pandemic is over to file for divorce. They tell them, you know, with the court closures, with the added stress and cases piling up, you know, there may be a delay in getting their divorce through the courts. So they're telling them, okay, just wait, you know, right now, because it seems like everyone is filing for divorce. Can you believe that? And, you know, there's this Hollywood actress. Her name is Jada Pinkett Smith. You probably heard of her. You know, she had opened up on her talk show about how the coronavirus pandemic had affected her relationship with her husband, Will Smith. You probably heard of Will Smith. He's been in a lot of movies over the years. But you know, the episode was entitled, How Your Relationship Can Survive the Quarantine. And the 48-year-old talk show host candidly admitted that one of the things that she realized is that she really doesn't know her husband, Will, at all. And she continues. This is what she says. She says, let me tell you that it's been something to be married to somebody for 20-some-odd years and realize, hey, I don't know you and you really don't know me. And also realizing that an aspect of yourself, you don't really know about yourself either. And she added, the thing that Will and I are learning to do is to be friends. You get into all these ideas of what intimate relationships are supposed to look like, what marriages are supposed to be. Will and I are in the process of him taking the time to learn to love himself, me taking the time to love myself, and us building a friendship along the way. And Jada says, it's challenging. You're forced to look at things differently, referring to how quarantining as a couple can affect one's relationship. And you know, the actress later admitted that sometimes she goes straight to fight mode. You know, sometimes she snaps and she's just like, oh, just giving Will the business. And she says she can't help herself. And here's the thing. So what did they do? They got help from this personal relationship counselor. And supposedly this counselor is supposed to give them healthy relationship tools so that they can put it into practice and learn to live with each other. I gotta tell you, I never watched the show, but I know for a fact we got something even better. We got God's Word, and this is the best tool that can revive and restore any relationship that is strained because of a pandemic or for whatever reason there may be. Because when we turn to the Word of God gives us wisdom. And it teaches us how to really have blessed relationships. And, you know, when we look to the world for advice and counseling, oh, that's when we can get into more trouble. You know, just recently I heard this psychology professor and counselor make this statement. This is what she said. She says, marriage is based on a contractual agreement. And just like any contract, if it doesn't work out, you can legally break that contract and get a divorce. Well, how would you like this person to be your marriage counselor? No, thank you. I got to tell you, I'm going to look to the Word of God. I'm going to look for godly counsel so that truly all my relationships will be blessed. Amen. Well, look at that question there. It says, how can we stay at home with our family members for extended hours without strangling each other to death. Well, number one, it says you got to choose to be nice and kind towards one another at all times. Hey, it's a choice you make. Don't ever say, I can't help myself. You know, when I'm around this person, I just turn mean. I just turn nasty. I just can't help myself to be cruel, you know, towards this person. No, you can help yourself because you know what? You are a believer. You are controlled by the Holy Spirit of God. Amen. And so we got to choose to be nice and kind, you know, towards especially our loved ones. You know, as the saying goes, right? A little kindness can go a long way. You just do something just to show the person that, you know, you really care about them. Suddenly you realize they're going to just return that niceness, that kindness back to you. You know, the truth of the matter is that sometimes we can be more kind to strangers than our loved ones. Come on, isn't that true? You know, because we already have like an established relationship with our loved one, and we may think, that person will understand me. You know, I can never hurt this person. I can never hurt their feelings because they will always be able to tolerate our mean and grumpy behavior. Well, let me tell you something. If you think that, there's going to come a point this person is going to have a breaking point. And, you know, we keep doing that and we keep saying, nah, it's okay. Nah, I can just, you know, constantly snap at this person and they're fine. No, don't think like that. Because, you know, deep down inside, this person may be hurting. And often they have to bear and grin it all that you're dishing out upon them. And they tolerate it and they got to put on a happy face. And deep down, no, they're hurting. And how do I know this? Well, I talk to people and sometimes they just open up and say, you know, there's only so much I can take, Pastor Ben. You know, it's really getting to me. You know, my loved ones, it's just affecting me in such a bad way. I want you to look what it says here in Proverbs 11:17. It says here, those who are kind benefit themselves, but the cruel bring ruin on themselves. Let me read it again. Those who are kind benefit themselves. You will reap the benefits. You're going to have blessed relationships. But if you're cruel, yeah, you're going to bring ruin to all your relationships. And whatever may be blessings in your life may come to ruin. You know, we got to understand this also includes our loved ones. Because if it's a constant repeat of the same offense, you're saying things to hurt them and it's over and over and over again, there's going to be a breakdown of the relationship. We got to understand that. We cannot just keep thinking, nah, they understand, no worry, you know, they love me and I love them, they know that, so no worries. Well, we know, especially now with the pandemic, we're with each other, you know, longer periods of time, and it's increasing the likelihood of relationships being damaged if we're not careful with our words, if we're not careful with what we're doing. And so, you know, Proverbs 31, it describes a godly woman of great wisdom. And it appears this woman, she is the super glue that holds the family together. I want you to look at that. Proverbs 31, 25 to 27. It says here, strength and dignity are her clothing, and she laughs at the time to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. She looks well to the ways of her household, and she does not eat the bread of idleness. Not only does this godly woman teach her children how to be kind to other people, guess what? She's modeling it. She's showing to people that I'm like this because I know this is important, that we have to be kind towards each other and towards the people that we come in contact with. And it tells us she's never idle. It means that she's never taking time to you know, just rest and relax. No, she's going out of her way, looking for ways to bring her family close together, to be kind to them, to show that this is of great importance to her, that we are to, you know, stay together as a strong unit, as a family. We are Ohana, as my dad used to say, you know, that we have to make sure we're loving each other very deeply. You know, I gotta tell you, in a village in New England, there was talk of an extraordinarily beautiful woman that was married to an extraordinarily ugly man. okay? And when a family friend once asked her how such a beautiful woman could have married such an ugly man, you know what her reply was? She replied, "He has never once hurt my feelings. Therefore, he has never been ugly to me." Wow. Like they say, right? True beauty is truly skin deep. And that's what it is. When we're kind to one another, people see the beauty that is inside and out, because it shows, right? It shows from inside coming out. You know, we may not look as beautiful as some other person, but the fact is, when we got beauty inside, this is what people take notice of. The beauty that is genuine, the beauty that is real from your heart, from your soul. I want you to look what it says here in Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 to 4. It says here, "Don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble, thinking of others as better than yourselves. Don't look out only for your own interests, but take an interest in others too." And it's so important, right? We cannot always go through life thinking it's about me, myself, and I. It says take an interest in other people too. And just realize there are things you can do to really put a smile on their faces. And once there was this elderly woman named Mamie Adams. And she always went to this branch post office in her town because the postal employees there, they were always so friendly to her, always showing that, you know, they had concern for her. So one day she went to buy stamps, and this was actually before Christmas one year, and the lines were particularly long. And, you know, someone pointed out to Mamie, telling her, "You know what, you don't have to wait in line because there's a stamp machine in the lobby." And Mamie, she says, "I know, but the machine won't ask me about my arthritis." Can you see this? People are drawn to people who are nice and kind and concerned about them. And I'm sure you can think of many instances in which you choose a certain business over another one simply because the people were friendlier than the other one. I got to tell you, I remember years ago, you know, when I was in my 20s, I wanted to sign up for membership in a gym. And I kind of looked around, you know, and I came to like three that I kind of thought that I would want to join. And guess what? I ended up choosing the smallest and grungiest one. And, you know, and you got to understand, the membership was about the same price as the others. And why did I choose this one? Well, you know what? The owner of the gym gave me special attention. You know, on the first day I met this guy, he was like, "Okay, tell me what your goals are. You know, I will help you get there. You know, I'll make sure that you will achieve your goals." And wow, so nice, so friendly. And I just thought, hey, I want to go with this guy, you know. Even though, you know, the other gyms are fancier and cleaner and all that. No, I went to this guy because this guy really showed genuine concern about me. Let me ask you something. When was the last time you ever asked your loved one, you know, who you're staying home at with all the time, right? Did you ever ask them, "Hey, how are you doing? Can I do anything for you?" Hey, come on, it's important. We got to do these things. You know, we got to ask each other, "How are you doing? Is there anything I can do for you?" You know, this is what you do to show people that you really care about them, that you really love them. And, you know, this is what Apostle Paul says in Colossians chapter 3. Verses 12 to 13. He says here, "Put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other, as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive." You know, it tells us, you got to put it on as God's chosen ones, you know, that we are to have compassionate hearts. We got to have kindness towards other, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another in love. You know, if we're not doing these things, the world's going to kind of look at us and go, "Wow, you're no different from me or anybody else in this world." You know, because sometimes people can be pretty mean in this world. And if we're representing Christ well, they should see that, no, we're different, that we truly have a kindness like no other, a genuine love for other people. You know, it has been said that kindness makes a person attractive. And it says, if you would win the world, you got to melt it, not hammer it. Yeah, we got to melt the world, not hammer it, because sometimes we can hammer people. We kind of go, but you're not doing what I'm telling you to do. You're not listening to me. And we just hammer, hammer, hammer. But if we take the time to show kindness and loving concern for them, you're going to melt their hearts. And suddenly, they're going to go, wow, I really love you. You know, I can see that you really love me, and I just want to return that love, you know, to you, because you are showing that you really care about me. And it's important that as human beings, we are to do this, because if not, we're not going to have relationships that are blessed. I want you to look at number two now. It says, choose to be at peace with each other and be willing to forgive at all times. I got to ask you something. Have you ever gone to someone's house and you just sense there's so much tension? You know, and a lot of times, right, the family may be trying to cover up the hostility and the unforgiveness that they have for each other. But you see it through their fake smiles. You know, you probably know for a fact they had a fight before you came, and there probably had been an intense battle zone in their homes, you know, in their house before you arrived. And, you know, you just kind of wonder how long they've been doing this, you know, yelling at each other and really just bickering. But you know, right? Sometimes we can walk into a household and the atmosphere is just, man, it's terrible. You know, you just feel it. There's tension in the air. And you're just wanting to leave. But, you know, look what it says here in Matthew chapter 6, verses 12 to 15. Look what Jesus says. He says, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. And you got to realize, when there is a household that is filled with unforgiveness, you know, just people just always at each other's throat, right? I mean, it's going to be only getting worse. And I got to tell you, what's even worse is when there's total silent treatment towards each other in the household, where, man, you're just feeling so uncomfortable because it affects everyone in the family. It could be, let's say, between the parents, you know, the mother and the father. And the children, they're just miserable because, guess what, the parents aren't talking to each other. And sometimes that kind of silence can bring forth even more strife in a household because no one wants to talk to each other. So the children, they don't talk to each other. They don't talk to the parents. Nobody talks to each other. And everyone is stressed out. And you got to be willing to forgive, because the Bible says you're not willing to forgive, Father God will not forgive you also. You got to choose to say, you know what, I'm going to humble myself. I'm going to show to the person, hey, I'm not going to let this affect me. I'm not going to make it so that it becomes only worse. You know, you got to make a decision. Are you going to put an end to it? Because if unforgiveness is constant in the atmosphere of a household, especially during a pandemic where everyone is at home, it can be so unbearable, because guess what? The presence of God will definitely be lacking. You know, because where the presence of God is, there is fullness of joy. There is great peace. And when you're not willing to forgive, God's not going to forgive you either. And guess what? You're not going to have peace at all in your homes. But when you are filled with the presence of God and you're quick to forgive others, guess what? You're not going to be so sensitive around other people, especially your loved ones. And, you know, there's this well-known secular humanist, and she's also an atheist novelist. Her name is Marganita Lasky. You know, this is what she says. Her statement is, what I envy most about you Christians is your forgiveness. I have nobody to forgive me. Just imagine the fact that all your friends, your families, and even your acquaintances, right, they hold bitterness and unforgiveness towards you. And they just won't choose to forgive you. You know, even though you may express that, you know, you're sorry, they won't forgive you, right? But, you know, you gotta ask, what do you think, you know, is the reason that this person would have people that won't forgive him or her? It's probably because this person is not a very forgiving person himself. Isn't that true? If you're not a very forgiving person, there's going to be people around you. They're not going to be forgiving you either. And that's why it's kind of like it goes around and round and round. And it's just like it gets worse and worse. And nobody's going to want to forgive you. You're not going to want to forgive anybody. And it only becomes worse and worse as there's bitterness at all times. So we got to be careful of this. And as Christians, we must not allow ourselves to get to the point where we become angry and bitter towards everyone. Because, yeah, with anger, you're going to have bitterness. And bitterness is something that grips your heart and does not allow you to show any love towards the other person. You know, because you're bitter. You can't allow your heart to experience the sweetness of God's love in your life. And you got to get rid of this bitterness. Look what it says here in Proverbs 19:11. It says here, good sense makes one slow to anger, and it is his glory to overlook an offense. And what is good sense? You know, we're talking about godly sense. If you're in the Word, you're following the Word of God, it gives you good sense. It's going to tell you, you know, don't allow, you know, what other people say to you affect you, that you get upset so easily, that you're wanting to destroy the other person. And it says it is his glory to overlook an offense. If you got good sense, you got godly sense, you're just going to let these terrible words, you know, hurtful words, just kind of like hit you. But it's just like Teflon, it slides right off. It's not going to get so deep into your mind that it will affect your heart. It just slips off because the Word of God tells you who you are. You remember that you are a child of God. And you're not going to let the words of people destroy you. You're not going to let the words of people affect the very fact that you are so loved by God. Look what it says here in Proverbs 12:16. It says, a fool is quick-tempered, but a wise person stays calm when insulted. And, you know, what makes this person wise? Well, it's the wisdom that comes from the Word of God. It comes from the very fact that this person is in tune to God's Word and the voice of the Holy Spirit. You know, because this person is always in the Word of God. And when you're always in the Word of God, guess what? You're going to hear from the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is always going to speak to you. And this is what gives you godly wisdom. So when you follow what the Holy Spirit says, guess what? You're not going to go always like, you know, off the edge, you know, of the cliff. You're always going to stay calm. As the Bible says, even you're insulted, you're going to be cool, calm, and collected. And you're going to show to this person, hey, it's not going to affect me because the Word of God is in me. I know what to say. I know what to do. And I choose to love you regardless of what you're going to say to me. I'm going to tell you, this is how powerful the Word of God is. This is what you can do to a person when you truly take the Word of God and apply it to your life. And look what this next scripture says here in Proverbs 17:13-14. It says here, if you repay good with evil, evil will never leave your house. And it says, starting a quarrel is like opening a floodgate. So stop before a dispute breaks out. Once again, let me read it. If you repay good with evil, evil will never leave your house. Starting a quarrel is like opening a floodgate. You know what a floodgate is? You know, let's say it's holding back this water. Maybe it's been raining for a long period of time. It's holding back water. And if you open the gate, guess what happens? The water just rushes out, right? And it's just like you're going to be swept over. And guess what? Suddenly, wow, what happened here? Yeah. And we got to understand from the experiences that we gain through our lives, we should know better, you know, to pick a fight with someone that we know is always wanting to destroy someone. You know, someone who's always angry and upset at other people. Don't pick fights, you know, period. But especially for people that you know that really they will explode, you know, when you pick a fight with them. And it says starting a quarrel is like opening a floodgate. So don't start. Don't go near that. You know, just make it a point. You're gonna think ahead. If I say something to offend this person or say something to hurt this person, you know, what's gonna happen? You know, if you know this person already, this person is gonna explode. Why are you going to continue? No, you stop. You know, the devil wants you to say, you know, whatever it is that will just offset this person. You know, to get this person upset. Don't do it. Just say, no, I'm not gonna do it. You know, and just walk away and just allow yourself to be a person who creates peace within your household. And look what it says here in Romans 12:17-18. It says, do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on who? Depends on you. Live at peace with everyone. You know, we got to understand, it really depends on us sometime whether or not we're going to have a household that is filled with peace. Because you can blame the other person all you want. But, you know, if you're not going to be the one to say, you know what, I'm also to blame. You know, I could be part of the problem. And, you know, you just say, you know what, I'm not going to do the things that will get people upset anymore. You're just going to be one who will create peace in your household. It depends on you that you want to live at peace. So sometimes you got to walk away. And sometimes you got to make the extra effort to show kindness towards someone. Make the extra effort to show people that you love them. I want you to look what it says here. Hebrews 12:14-15. It says, make every effort to live in peace with everyone and to be holy. Without holiness, no one will see the Lord. See to it that no one falls short of the grace of God and that no bitter root grows up to cause trouble and defile many. What does it say there? Make every effort. Because sometimes, you know, I'll counsel a couple and, you know, sometimes either the husband or wife say, you know, I'm trying my best. And, you know, and I ask them, what have you done? And sometimes they scratch their head and say, well, I know I did something. I just can't think of it right now. And, you know, I just kind of wonder, are you really making every effort as the Bible tells us to? Because if you want to be at peace in your relationship with someone, with someone, it should be that you're going to ask the Lord, whatever it takes, Lord, help me. Help me to be humble that I will be able to do the very things to show this person that I don't want to be in strife with him or her, that I want peace. You're going to make every effort. And as God humbles your heart, you know, it may be that you're not going to want to do it at first. You know, God may tell you, oh, go buy your wife some flowers then. Even though your wife is at your throat. No, go show to her that you really love her. And I'm going to tell you, when couples, they realize they got to humble themselves and do the very things they don't want to do, but they do it anyway. Guess what? Their relationships get better and better. And suddenly they go, wow, I should have done this sooner. And that's why we realize the Word of God tells us it's so important that we have to humble ourselves and be willing to love in a way that is not like the world. No, it's totally of God. It's the kind of love that you know it's coming from the Lord. Which brings us to point number 3. It says here, choose to love each other deeply, deeply at all times. Yeah, I got to emphasize that word deeply. You know, many couples will say that they love their spouses and, you know, and their other family members. But, you know, since the pandemic, right, you know, with their extended hours together, somehow, you know, some people will say their affections towards one another is not the same. It somehow has diminished. And, you know, some may quote the saying, absence makes the heart grow fonder, right? And now they may say, with no absence, because we're always with each other, you know, the fondness has just disappeared. And you kind of have to ask, really? The fondness is gone because there's no absence? Yeah, I gotta tell you, recently I saw this cartoon comic strip in which there are 5 or 6 dogs that are sitting at a conference table. And the dog at the end of the table, right, he says, my fellow canines, there is great success with Operation COVID-19. Now all of our masters and their families have to stay at home with us all the time. And they look so happy, right? But then on the other end of the table, there's this cat. And this cat is saying, hey, I just want to know why I wasn't informed of this stupid operation. And here's the thing, right? We know dogs, they love to show affection to their owners. And you know, the owners usually, you know, love to give their affection to their dogs. But cats, they're kind of like, hey, just leave me alone. I like to be by myself. And it's true, right? You ever watch on YouTube, where was this cat, the family filmed this their family cat making screeching and hissing noises at them. Why? Because they're at home. You know, they're usually not at home, and now suddenly, hey, how come they're in my house? You know, the cat is thinking. And so the thing is, right, regardless if we spend a little or a lot of time with each other, the love should never stop, you know, and we're not dogs and we're not cats. We're not animals, right? But we're human beings that have intellect and emotions. And you know, intellectually, we should realize, you know, our emotions are very important. You know, the very fact is it will determine how we feel towards our loved ones and how they feel towards us. And intellectually, we should think of ways to show to each other how much we care for each other. And we should be loving each other without stopping. Look what Proverbs 17:17 says. It says here, a friend loves at all times, and a brother is born for a time of adversity. Wow, a friend loves how often? At all times. And a brother is born for a time of adversity. When problem comes, hey, there he or she is. They're ready to support and help the other person so that this person can get back on their feet. So this answers the question of when, right? When meaning how often, right? It's at all times. The question now is, how are we to love each other? Well, look what it says here in 1 Peter 1:21 to 22. It says, through Christ you have come to trust in God, and you have placed your faith and hope in God because he raised Christ from the dead and gave him great glory. You are cleansed from your sins when you obey the truth. So now you must show sincere love to each other as brothers and sisters. Love each other deeply with all of your heart. Okay. So what does it mean to love deeply? What is Peter telling us? I mean, how do you love deeply, right? We're not talking about our own human love. When you go so deep, you know that Christ is in your heart. The Bible says when you ask Christ to enter in to your heart, he made your heart his home. This is what the Bible tells us. And so you got to go real deep. When you say you love someone, you got to love with the very love of God. Go so deep within your heart and ask God, how can I show to this person that I really love him? And look what it says here in John 13, 34 to 35. It says here, a new commandment, which is Jesus, right? I give to you that you love one another just as I have loved you. But you also are to love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. Did you get that? It says that we are to love one another just as Jesus has loved you. Can you actually say that you've been loving your family members the way that Jesus loves you? Ask yourself that, because that's what it tells us to do. Because when we get deep enough into our hearts, you're going to find the love of Christ. And really, sometimes, you know, we can just easily say it with our mouth. Oh, I love you. I love you. But if you're not showing it with your actions, hey, come on. You know, it really has to go deep to the point where you're going to hit the jackpot, you know, so to speak, right? Where you know it's the love of God. When you go so deep, you're humbling yourself. You're showing to God that I really want to go deep. And, well, what is the love of God? What is it like anyway? Well, it tells us in the Bible, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, 4 to 7. Okay, look what it says there. I'm sure you know the scripture. It says, love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud. It does not dishonor others, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, it always trusts, it always hopes, and always perseveres. Wow. And you know, someone may say, hey, Pastor Ben, I do some of these things, you know, sometimes I'm patient, you know, and sometimes, you know, I show to the person that I'm not easily angered, you know, I don't keep a record of wrong. I know I don't do everyone that's on this list, but, you know, I do most, right? But you know what? If you really want to love God's way, love the way God loves you, guess what? It should be all of these things. And, you know, that's why we got to go through this list where, you know, where it says love, we put our name there. We got to ask ourselves, you know, like, for example, I would put my name. Ben is patient. Ben is kind. I got to ask myself, is that true? You know, and I can direct it towards a person. You know, am I patient? Am I kind towards John Lee? Oh, you know, I think it's important. And we got to ask ourselves, if we're not a certain thing on this list, you got to ask God to help you to become more like that. Because guess what? When you can embrace all these things, that is love. That is God's love, right? In your life towards another person who is called your loved one, guess what? Your relationship with that person is going to be so blessed. Guaranteed. It's when you love the way God loves you. It's when you do that. Because when you do that, you're going to realize, you know, you may have had, you know, bad or ill feelings towards that person, but suddenly, oh, it's becoming less and less and less when you go through this list and you ask the Holy Spirit to correct you, to help you to love the way He wants you to love this person. I want you to look what it says here in 1 John chapter 3, verses 18 to 19. Look what it says there. Dear children, let's not merely say that we love each other. Let us show the truth by what? Our actions. Our actions will show that we belong to the truth so that we will be confident when we stand before God. Wow. Like I said earlier, you know, don't merely just say, but I love you. You should know that already. You know, no, it's by your actions. What are you doing to show this person that you really love them? Because it says our actions will show that we belong to the truth of God, to the truth of who Jesus is, knowing that we're loving with the very love of Christ. And this will make all the difference in the world, brothers and sisters, when you can do this. Amen? Well, I want you to take a look at the bottom line verses now. Let's look at Philippians 2. Verses 5 through 7. Look what it says there. Look what Paul says. He says, have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped. But look what it says there. This is very important. It says here, he emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of man. And you got to understand, you probably knew, right? I would bring up humility. I always do when, you know, my sermons have to do with relationships. You know, the Word of God always points us back to us being humble, that we must have humility. And with that, right, there comes a word that many people don't like, especially when I counsel married couples. I think you know what that word is. Well, let's look at Ephesians chapter 5. 21 to 26. Look what it says there. It says, and further, there's that word, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. For wives, this means submit to your husbands as to the Lord. For a husband is the head of his wife, as Christ is the head of the church. He is the savior of his body, the church. As the church submits to Christ, so you wives should submit to your husbands in everything. For husbands, this means loving your wife, just as Christ loved the church. He gave up his life for her to make her holy and clean, washed by the cleansing of God's word. You know, sometimes when I'm counseling a couple, you know, the wife may say, you know, Pastor Ben, the reason why I don't submit to my husband is because he doesn't love me like that. He doesn't love me like the way Jesus will love me. And the husband would, you know, turn back and say, well, the reason why I don't love her like that is because she doesn't submit to me the way that we should submit to Christ, right? And you kind of go, wow, what are you going to do, right? We won't get anywhere unless someone is willing to humble themselves. And you know, the scripture says, out of reverence for Christ, we should submit to one another. And what does submit mean? Well, the definition means to humbly yield to one another. It means, you know what, don't make a big deal that you always have to be the one that's right, that you always have to be the one that's, you know, the one who is on the top and that everyone else is below you. No, you got to submit to one another out of reverence for Christ, knowing what Christ did for you. Out of his pure and genuine love for you, he was willing to sacrifice his love for you. And we should be willing to do that, to say, you know what, it don't matter. Because sometimes, you know, I hear a guy say, but I'm the husband. She has to submit to me. You know, when you say things like that, it's only going to make it worse. I hope you realize that, buddy. You know, because, and for the woman, right, when you're saying, you know, he doesn't love me, you got to ask yourself why. You know, is it because that you're always wanting it your way? Oh, but I know I can get in trouble for this. But no, seriously, right? The Bible says, out of reverence for Christ, we got to submit to each other and don't make it such a big deal that you're the one who always got to have it your way. I know this isn't easy to hear, but it's for all of us, including myself. Let me tell you, brothers and sisters, because I want to see your relationships blessed. I want to see that your relationships with your spouse, with your children, you know, whatever relationship that you have will be blessed. But the only way that's going to happen, it got to start with you. It's got to start with me. And we got to realize, yeah, there are times we really need to humble ourselves. And look what it says here in Matthew 12, 47 to 50. You know, someone goes to Jesus, right? And this is what they say. Someone told him, meaning Jesus, your mother and brothers are standing outside wanting to speak to you. And Jesus replied to him, who is my mother and who are my brothers? And pointing to his disciples, he said, hey, here are my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother, my sister, and my mother. So what is Jesus trying to say here, right, in this scripture? You know, when it concerns a family in the physical, right, we could be a husband, a wife, a son or daughter, or a brother or sister. But, you know, when we're talking in the spiritual sense, you're all brothers and sisters in Christ. Jesus is saying, whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother. This is my spiritual family. And, you know, instead of looking at the person, oh, that's my wife, because we see them in the physical, right? That's my wife, or that's my husband, that's my kid. They have to follow me because I'm the one that they have to submit to. I'm the one that's the parent. I'm the one that they got to listen to whether they like it or not. You know, when you come across being so stern, so harsh, it only turns the person farther away. You know, that's what I want to say. I know sometimes I can be like that too, brothers and sisters. I'm going to be honest with you, as a parent or even as a husband. But you know, sometimes God tells me, stop, Ben. You know, the Holy Spirit says, Ben, yeah, Jonna Lee is your wife. But you know what? She's also my daughter, which makes her your sister in Christ. And I go, you're right, Lord. Oh, I'm so sorry. And you know, even for your children, did you know the fact is, yeah, they're your son, they're your daughter. But in the spiritual realm, yeah, because they're believers, they're your brother and sister in Christ too. So, just like my son Benson and my daughter Abigail, guess what? Yeah, they're my son and they're my daughter, but they are also my brother and sister in Christ. You know, it's so important, right, that we do not allow ourselves to put ourselves in a position that rethink that. We're always higher than our other family members. You know, the Bible says, submit to one another in reverence to Christ. You know, yes, it is true that, you know, as a father, I am to be honored by them. I have this, you can say, higher authority over them, but I do not do it in a way that is harsh, that is mean, you know, that you better listen to me or else you're going to get it. No, don't act like that. Don't say things like that. You know, show the love of Christ. And as we do this, you know, you're going to get the respect that you want from your family members. But remember, it always starts with us. We got to learn to love deeply, more and more each and every day. As we draw close to God, as we learn to love God more and more every day, guess what? The love will overflow in the lives of your family also. And so let's make that point that we're going to do it, that we're going to allow our love to get deeper and stronger, you know, not only for our family members, but for Christ. And you're going to see how, you know, even though you're at home with each other all the time, no, your love will only get deeper and stronger for one another. Amen. Praise the Lord. Why don't we go ahead? Let's close with a word of prayer. Let's come before our Father in heaven. Let's pray. Father God, I just want to thank you, Lord, for the message spoken today. And Father God, I know for some of us, we're always with each other. You know, it seems like 24/7 we are with our families. And it should be such a wonderful thing. But if it is, for some people, maybe something that's causing you a lot of stress. Maybe you're getting to the point you really want to strangle your loved one. I pray, Father God, that your Holy Spirit will come and just fill their minds and fill their hearts. As they have listened to your word today, I pray, Lord, that their hearts will be filled with the very love of your Son, Jesus Christ. That they will not want to strangle their loved ones, but no, they want to embrace them wholeheartedly, because they're filled with the love of our Lord Jesus Christ. Father, I pray you will help us to only grow deeper and stronger in our relationships with you and with each other. Because, Father, this is what life is all about. When we can truly love the way you have shown your love to us, Father, we know we're going to have such a blessed life. Father, we love you. We praise you. We thank you, Lord, for what you have started in our lives and what you will continue to do. We give you all glory, honor, and praise. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray all these things. We all say, Amen. Well, thank you, brothers and sisters, for being here today. I'll see you again next week. All right, praise the Lord. Give God all the glory.